And of course, welcome you to this new week of lectures. Today we will be dealing with a quite interesting topic. You will see that in the next slides. As always, here are the classroom principles, even though I know that we are not in the campus yet, but you will be visiting the campus for at least for some labs. So it's very good to have it over there. And again, if you, well, I believe that up to this point you didn't get the opportunity to visit the campus, but you can do that online if you want. If you click on this link over here, you can take a virtual tour. And this is the link to our opening event for the building of the School of Architecture and the Environment. Now, today we will be discussing a lot. Well, today's presentation is all about actually stresses and strains. We will define what the stress and the strain is, the types of different types of stresses and strains, and how they are used in order to firstly analyze our structures and then design them. Of course, we won't go into too much detail in the design of structures because this is out of scope of this module. However, stresses are actually, and strains are actually what we use in our design. But first, let's define what the stress is. Now, up to this point, when we were discussing about solid bodies and the transmission of forces, we assumed that the force would travel through a body as a simple force as it is. So if, for example, we had the F3 over here, the principle of transmissibility would apply, meaning that this force would be transmitted through the rigid body in the same line of action and the same direction, but as a simple force. However, we already knew that this is a simplification. This is not the case in nature. What happens in nature, well, what I will tell you now is still a simplification, but a much more efficient than the previous one. So this force actually is distributed all over the element on which it applies. This one has an arbitrary shape, so let me just draw a simple, let's say, a cube over here. So if a force F applies on the cube, of course, if we go to the bottom of the cube, we would need to have another force F in the opposite direction so that this solid body would be in equilibrium, meaning that it would not accelerate or tend to move. So this force does not actually transmit through the body a point load, but it is distributed all over the area on which it applies. So over here, this would actually look like that. And it would be practically the same thing on the other side. Now, this distributed load that you see over here is not distributed only in one direction. So it is not a UDL that we have been dealing with in the past, but it is distributed in two directions. In other words, it is distributed all over the area. Now, this is what we call the stress, and we use the Greek letter sigma. Sigma is the Greek letter for S, coming, of course, from stresses. Now, the stress, this is what we call the direct stress, actually, is defined as the force over a small area, or the resultant force, if we have a UDL over here, over this area. So, if I could just write the formula over here, sigma equals F over A. It is that simple. Of course, in other modules, actually, you will see that the distribution of a point load into stresses does not take place instantly. So it is not that it applies on an area and it is distributed directly. It happens gradually. So initially the stresses are more concentrated close to the load, and then they become smaller. But this is a relatively good approximation, the one that we're using here. And it is quite handy when we want to apply the theory that we've got available. So this is what we will be using. Now, in general, the stress is force over area. But then comes a question, a logical one, that says, well, okay, but what if the force was not normal to this surface, meaning that it is not perpendicular to this plane, but it was actually parallel to a surface, perhaps parallel to this one instead. So, in this case, if we try to analyze the force over the area, it will look like that. Now, again, this is stress. So, again, we have a distributed force all over the area on which it applies. However, because the force is not perpendicular to the surface of the area, but parallel to that, we distinguish between this type of stress and this type of stress. We call this type normal stress. And we call this type of stress shear stress. Now, in order to avoid any confusion, instead of sigma, for shear stresses, we are using the Greek letter tau. Tau is just the next letter in order. So since sigma was already taken, this is how this one came to be. It is Greek for T, but yeah, it is just related to sigma. So at this point, we have defined the types of stresses that we might have. Of course, as you might imagine, the direction here doesn't really matter. It could be like that, for example. This one would still be tau. It would still be a shear stress. So these are the two types of stresses that we have. The units we are using for stresses are megapascals. Well, initially they were the pascals, which is newtons over square meters. And these are the units in the international system, the SI, because Newton is a standard unit for force and meter is a standard unit for dimensions. But in general, in civil engineering, pascals are very, very small units. Now, to get an idea of how small they are, well, 1 kilogram is 9.81 newtons. So practically, we are talking about something more than 100 grams for each square meter. So it's a very, very small force over area. Of course, the stress is for civil engineering purposes next to nothing. And this is why we are typically using megapascals, which are newtons over square millimeters. 1 megapascal is 1 million pascals. So this is 10 to the 6th pascals. Now, in some literature, you might find stresses in kilopascals. But to be honest, it should be quite old literature. So for the past at least 20 years, we have been using megapascals. But nevertheless, it should not make any difference for you because the theory is the same. The units don't really change that. In the imperial system, we typically use PSIs, pounds per square inch. And in civil engineering, we typically use kilopounds per square inch. You will probably see these units in literature that uses both systems or the imperial only. Now, in this slide, you just see the discussion on normal and shear stress. But it is practically what we have already shown. And let me just draw this one a bit larger to explain how these stresses are defined, needed force. So here, what you will see once again, we have a cuboid. Now, depending on the direction of the force over the area, it might be normal or shear. So, for example, if we have a force acting, let's say, in this direction, this line is perpendicular to the plane, meaning that it is what we call normal. Once again, if we have a force in this direction, for this area, for this surface here, this would be a normal force. And of course, the stress would be a normal stress as well. And for this surface, it should be in this direction so that it would be normal. So one thing that I want you to keep from this slide is that whether you have normal or shear stresses depends on the surface over which the initial force or perhaps the distributed load applies on. So depends on the surface that you are using to calculate the stress. Is this clear? Thank you very much. So this one is sigma, this one is sigma, this one is sigma. If we are dealing with three-dimensional objects, then it might not be that convenient to use sigma for all of this because we would want to know the direction of the stress as well, not only its magnitude perhaps. So, in order to distinguish between these three, what we are doing is to define a coordinate system and say, for example, well, you know what? Here, we could have x, y, and z in some other cases, it might be, well, the vertical axis might be Z and the horizontal Y. It is still the same. So next to the let sigma, we will be using a letter to define the axis parallel to which the stress is. So this one would be sigma y, this one would be sigma x, and this one would be sigma z. And this is how we could define normal stresses on this object. But what about shear stresses? Well, if we have a force on this top surface that points, let's say, in this direction, this would be a shear stress, tau. Now, if we have another shear in this direction, it would also be tau. Okay. So let's just draw the same for the other surfaces. This is something that we know, well, or that we can understand now. And then we'll see the problem. Oh, okay, perhaps instead of this direction, I should draw this in this direction. It doesn't make any difference, but let me just draw it like that for consistency. When I make these notes available, I will just erase this part so there is no confusion. Now, well, okay, here we can have stresses in this direction or in this direction, and both of them would be shear stresses. But now, there is another problem. You see, if we use one direction, perhaps, let's say, the Y, or if we were to use, let's say, X or tau, then this one would be tau X, for example, and this one would also be tau X. So this would be a problem, because in this case we would have two different stresses acting on this body with the same name, so we could potentially confuse them. So what you will see over here is that to distinguish between the stresses, the first letter, well, we will be using two letters after the shear stresses. The first one has to do with the axis that is perpendicular to the plane on which the surface is. So the first letter is actually related to the shear, to the normal stresses on this surface. So this one would be tau y. Tau y. And the second letter would be on the, well, in the direction that the stress points at or acts on. So this would be tau yx and this would be tau yz. If we do that, we will see that all of these stresses would have a different name. So for example, this one would be tau zy and this one would be tau zx. This one would be tau xz, and this one would be tau xy. So, like that, we can define normal shear stresses in any direction for any surface. Is it clear how we name the stresses on an object? Mm-hmm. All right. so let's see some examples of stresses on objects. Now, here, what we've got is a bar. So this element here would practically be a bar. Now, a bar is an element that, if we are modeling as a linear element, we would draw with two hinges at the ends, and the bar would receive loads on its ends, not on over its span. So any load on the bar should be on its ends. Typically, bars only receive axial loads, and this is why, in this case, what we're drawing is something like that. Now, if we have an axial load, we know that, well, we might have modeled this element as a line because we assume it is a linear element. However, it does have a cross section. For example, it could be a solid circular section like the one you see over here. So if it does have a cross section, all we need to know is the area of this section to calculate the normal stresses on the bar. So in this case, the normal stresses on the bar, sigma, are the ones that you see over here. And distributed all over the area, it would be F over A. Of course, as you see the remark over here, the cube that you see drawn is virtually a point inside the bar, a point anywhere on the bar. So it would be, let's say, a particle inside the bar. Now, if instead of a force on this bar, we had a moment, a torsional moment, also referred to as torque, and this is why we use letter T. Well, first of all, it would not perform as if it was a bar, but now it would probably just be a shaft. Just to remind you what the torque would look like on this element, it would be a moment that tends to rotate it like that. So if this is the face of this shaft, the moment would tend to rotate it like that. What you see over here is the vector of the moment. And if you remember, I had mentioned that when it comes to moments, in the vector, we use two arrowheads over here so that it would show that this one is a moment while this one is a force. Also, let me remind you of the rule of the thumb of the right hand. So if the torque is in this direction, the thumb of the right hand would point outside of the slide, so in the direction that you see over here. Now, in order to calculate the stresses due to the torque, because the stresses will look something like that, what you see over here, we could not be using the area to divide that by, but we should be using something different. We will see that instead of the area, what we are using is the moment of area. We will define the moment of area later on, but in general, for the moment of area, we are using letters I or J, depending on what it is. Nevertheless, here, to define that, well, this would be the formula. But as I said, first we should define the second moment of area and come back to this formula to see how it can be utilized to calculate the stresses due to the torque. What I want you to keep in mind, though, is that this torsional moment, this torque over here, would actually cause shear stresses on the element. And the shear stresses, as you can read over here, are the tau xz stresses. Everything else should be zero. Now, that being said, well, before we discuss this slide, I want to let you all in a little secret. Well, it's not a secret, but it is something that is often ignored. You see, in nature, we don't have forces or stresses causing deformations, but we have actually the other way around. So there are deformations caused in the bodies, which result in stresses developing inside the bodies. If you keep that in mind, it is quite easy to see why various rules apply and how our theory comes to be. For example, it is mentioned here that, well, if we have a shear force on a surface, perhaps, well, let me draw this here instead. So if this would be a section of this beam, and let's assume that we have a shear force tau like that. And in the other direction, it would look like that. Now, what this shear force would tend to cause is a deformation on this surface. The deformed shape would look like that. Well, this is okay. This is something that we would expect, but in reality, we go from this deformation to these stresses, as I keep mentioning. Let's see a different scenario and see why all of these are important to keep in mind. What if we had a shear stress like that . How would this shear stress tend to deform this shape . So in this case it would tend to deform it something like that . Now in reality, it deforms like that in both cases. So in both scenarios, it would deform something like that. No surface would remain practically vertical or horizontal. Now, because it would deform like that, we can understand that we don't only have shear stresses in this direction, but we also have shear stresses in this direction. What I want to say is that, well, if we have a shear stress acting on our rigid body in any direction, we need to have a shear stress of the same magnitude acting in a direction perpendicular to that. So if we have, as you can see over here in this sketch, Let me just draw it like that. So if we have shear stress tau that you see in this element, we'll also have this tau dash acting on the element at the same time. Now, this tau dash has to be equal to tau so that the deformations would be compatible to each other. This is quite useful because this means that we don't really have to calculate anything new. We already know how much tau dash is. All we need to do is to acknowledge that this shear stress would be there. Because this is equal to this one, and they practically complement each other, we call this shear stress a complementary shear stress. So these stresses would come together in the same scenario. Now, having defined stresses, let's see something else, and then we will see how they correlate to each other. Well, when it comes to deformations of various structures or of various elements, well, it might be a bit inconvenient to measure the change in length. Let me show you a case where this would be inconvenient. Let's assume that we have some steel specimens. Typically, they would look something like that. Now, if we have a specimen with a clear length over here, L1, and we apply a force F1 up to the point that it will yield, we can calculate the stress at which it yields, because we can calculate the area of the specimen. So the yielding stress for this specimen would be the force over the area. Okay, this is clear. But then let's assume that we have another specimen, which, however, is a bit shorter than this one. F2. And L2. Now, if this specimen, the second specimen, is made of the same material that the first one is also made of, what we will see is that F2 over the area of the specimen should be equal to F1 over the area of the first specimen. In other words, the stress at which these two elements would yield should be the same. This means that here it is quite convenient to use stresses in order to calculate the strength of this material. However, let me just write this over here. Sigma 1 equals F1 over A1, and sigma 2 equals F2 over A2. So for the same material, sigma 1 has to be equal to sigma 2. Now, if we are calculating the deformations of these specimens, what we will see is that specimens that are larger will deform more. It is logical because, well, there is more material there to be deformed. So the change in length, delta L1, for example, let's assume that we will have an increase in length over here, would be larger than the increase in length in the second specimen, perhaps over here, delta L2. So this is a bit inconvenient because then we actually have nothing to compare these two. In other words, we might already know that we can use the stresses to compare the strength of the material or the forces, or actually translate the forces into something that is universal. However, if we want to do the same with the deformations, it is not possible using the change in length. After a number of experiments, it was noticed that, well, if we divide the change in length over the initial length, this ratio should be exactly the same if we have the same material. So the ratio of the change in length over the initial length has to be, well, it was noticed that it is the same for the same material, which means that this ratio, the ratio of the change in length over the initial length, is something quite convenient to use when it comes to defining our materials. Because after all, in order to define our materials, we want to know how they would perform under various stresses. So we have defined something new over here. This is what we call the strain. So the strain is, as I already mentioned, the change in length over the initial length of an element, or delta L over zero, refers to the initial, as you see over here. Now, okay, we have defined what the what strain is, but there is another issue over here. Actually, let me add the slide. So, if we have, let's say, this element over here, and then a force applies on the element, let's say F. In this case, we know that we will also have a stress of the force, but if I can model this element like that, and its deformed shape would look like that, if this is L and this is L dash, the strain in the element will be L dash minus L over L. Now, because this strain is parallel to this axis, which is perpendicular to the surface, this would be what we call a normal strain. It comes from the stresses that are related to this type of strain. So if we have normal stresses, we also have normal strains. It would be the same in any of the three directions in which we could have normal stresses. However, what would happen if on the same element I had a force in this direction, F? Well, this force would actually cause shear stresses. How? On this surface. And the deformation of this element would be something like that. Let me just draw this as well as possible. Or if I can draw this in two dimensions, it would look like that. Now here, the change in length might be virtually zero, not exactly zero. However, we can have a change in length in another direction. So if we call it delta L, and L would be the initial length of the element, let me show this over here again. So L and delta L, this change in length, or not exactly change in length, but in reality, the displacement horizontally over the initial length could also be a strain, but now we just use a different letter for the strain. So this one would be shear strain, while this one would be normal strain. The letters we are using for the strains are epsilon and gamma. Don't ask me why they are not related to strain. Strain, after all, starts from S. So, so is it clear how we define the strains and how we distinguish between normal and shear strains in objects? Yes, exactly. It is practically displacement, but in some literature you might find it as change in length, but it is not change in length, it is displacement, yes. All right. Here you can see how this would look like. Now, if the dimensions of our reference surface or element are very, very small, then the angle of the of the initial surface and the between the initial surface and the one of the deformed shape would be equal or very close to the tangent of the angle. So this angle can be defined as the shear strain. In general, even though it is assumed that the strain and the tangent would be equal to each other, I would not recommend that. I would not recommend using that as a rule in general. As I said, for very small angles, it is okay. But if the deformations start to become relatively excessive, then this rule does not apply, so it could give you incorrect results. Nevertheless, this is something that it is in the literature and it is considered to apply, but for this very specific scenario of very small deformations. Actually, before we discuss that, I believe we could have a break, if you want, for let's say about 10 minutes. So if everybody would be back around 10 o'clock, we can continue with the volumetric strain. We will define what this is and why this is of interest in civil engineering. So let me pause the recording now and I will resume it when we come back. We will be starting at 10 a.m. Now, let's discuss a little bit about the volumetric strain. First of all, before we see what the volumetric strain is, actually, let's make things more clear. You will see, if you haven't seen already, that we are using the term strain quite freely, meaning that initially we defined strain as the change of length over the length, and then we defined the shear strain as actually the displacement over the length, and the normal strain as the change in length over the length. And now we have volumetric strain, something related to the volume. So in general, the strain could be defined as the change in something over this initial something. Or perhaps it could be the change in something else over this initial something. I know that it might seem confusing when you just hear about strain. However, we have noticed that if we use normalized values, meaning that these values do not depend on the characteristics of the structures, but they mainly depend on the elements, then these values can be used to compare the performance of different specimens or elements or even structures. And this is why in civil engineering, but not only in civil engineering, actually in any field of science, we prefer to use normalized values, such as the strains. Because of that, we have come to the understanding that it is quite useful to define the change in volume over the initial volume because this can be used when it comes to the performance of specific materials. For example, if some of you will read some more literature on the performance of reinforced concrete, you will see that to describe the performance of concrete under specific loads, the volumetric strain is used in the formulation that we're using for that. So the volumetric strain comes into use in one of the most prominent civil engineering materials nowadays, which is concrete. Of course, it's not only in concrete. The same type of strain can be used pretty much everywhere, but it is one of the applications that you might come across. Now, this volumetric strain typically is denoted like that, EV, where V comes from volume, of course, not E, sorry, epsilon, V. And it can be proven that if we have a cube and we assume that we have the same change in length in every direction, then the volumetric strain is practically three times the normal strain. Now, it can also be proven that this shape does not have to be a cube. It is exactly the same for other shapes. However, of course, we will not go into detail here and we will not be proving that. But it is good to keep this formula in mind, that EV equals three times E, epsilon. But okay, we have defined stresses, we have defined strains. Why do we do all of that? Well, the main reason, as I said, is to be able to characterize our materials and also to make it possible to compare the performance of structures or of different elements with each other. So when it comes to materials, something that we try to define from our tests, but one of the things that we try to define in our tests, but it is usually the first one, is a relationship between stresses and strains. For example, over here, what you see is a graph where we have plotted the measured stresses and strains of a specimen, of a steel specimen in this case, as we apply a force on that and we increase the load. So if let me draw this perhaps over here. Let's just, well, here it is mentioned that it is a steel rod. It could be pretty much anything. So if we were in the lab, and once again, this would be our steel specimen. Now the area of this specimen would look something like that, and the area would be A. The force would be F. So the normal stress would be F over A. Now, as you can imagine, if we start with a small force, we will get a small stress. As we increase the forces, the stresses will increase as well. Now, if we try to plot this relationship between stresses and strains instead of forces and change in length. And as I mentioned, the reason we do that is because we want to see how the material performs and not how the particular specimen performs. Here we would have stresses and here we would have the strains. So the larger the stress, the larger the strain. However, there is a point, after which the stresses are not proportional to the strains, but up to this point, this is what happens. They are proportional. This is something that was observed literally hundreds of years ago. But of course, it would have to be described somehow. Now, this relationship was initially described by Hooke, who was actually performing tests with springs. And he noticed that the larger the force he would apply on the spring, the larger the deformation of the spring. So he said that, well, the force and the deformation need to be related somehow. So there is a factor over there that multiplies perhaps the deformations and gives you the forces. Something similar applies on the materials. So you can see that over here, sigma equals something times epsilon. Now, even if we do not know what this something is, we can define it because it is a proportional relationship. So this something would be a number. Now, for this number, we use capital E. And the reason is that this is what we call the modulus of elasticity. Let me write this over here. So E comes from elasticity, or Young's modulus. You will see that later in the slides or in other examples. So it has been verified experimentally that for all materials, there is, if we draw the stress strain diagram, there is a branch of the curve that is linear. And on this branch, it is possible to define the relationship between stresses and strains as a linear one. Now, it has also been observed that this modulus of elasticity depends on the material. So different materials will have a different modulus of elasticity. For example, when it comes to steel, this modulus of elasticity, depending on the carbon content and, well, not only that, but actually a few more properties of the steel, this modulus of elasticity can range from 195 gigapascals, so 195,000 megapascals, up to 210 gigapascals. For example, for concrete, it is actually related to the strength of the concrete, but it can range from like 20 gigapascals up to 35, 38 or more, depending, as I said, on the strength of the concrete. But nevertheless, this modulus of elasticity is something that can be used to define our materials. So it is a very useful value. And we will be using this from now on. Now let's define the rest of this curve, and then we will go back to the stresses and strains. So when it comes to steel, what happens is that, well, there is a point up to which, if we release the specimen, it will return to its initial state. So it will get back to its initial length. We can do that virtually as many times as we want. In reality, if we do that a very, very, very large number of times, it might not be exactly the same, but still it's something that is, let's say, almost theoretical. So for all of our purposes, if the stresses are within this limit, and there is a limit over here, then any deformation applied on this specimen can be undone. However, after this point, if we keep increasing the force, well, it will be able to receive the force, but if we release the specimen, then it will not return to its initial shape. It will have retained a number, an amount of this deformation. So what we said is that, well, we can certainly distinguish between this branch, this linear branch, and the rest of the curve, because in this linear branch, the behavior is an elastic one, meaning that it can deform and go back to its initial shape, while after that it is inelastic, non-elastic if you want, meaning that it will perform a bit differently. We also call this type of deformations as plastic deformations. Now, in steel, what happens is that after this point, there is a small range of deformations where it performs a bit strangely, not as strangely, but practically it seems as if it is, well, as if for the same stress, the strains increase. And then at some point, this starts to increase as well. Now, of course, there is a point where the specimen will just break apart. Now, we call this point, the limit of the elastic branch, the yielding point, as you can see over here, or the yield point. So this stress is the stress at yielding, Sy. And we call this point the, well, the stress at this point, the ultimate stress of that the material can receive. After that, we will have fracture. Also, similarly, we can define the strain at the yielding point, or the yielding strain, and the ultimate strain of this material. At some point, I will be uploading a video recording. Well, no need for that, because I have already done that in the materials, so there's no need to go into more detail, I believe. Am I correct? I will take it as a yes. That's true, yeah. You have already seen most of these properties. Nevertheless, what I want to highlight here is that this is the actual curve, but we, when it comes to steel, we are also using a theoretical one, which looks like that. So this is the actual, this is the theoretical one. The theoretical curve comes from the use of this formula, sigma equals F over A, for the whole loading program. So for the whole test, we are using this formula. So we divide the force over the initial area. However, when it comes to steel, you have discussed that after the yielding point, the area will start to decrease. And this is the phenomenon that we refer to as necking. So if you wanted to calculate the actual stresses, what you would need to do is to divide by the actual area. So if you divide by the actual area, you will get the actual curve. If you divide by the initial area, you will get the theoretical curve. Nevertheless, here we are using a lot the properties of the elastic branch of this material. So, as I mentioned earlier, Hook was doing tests for springs, and actually Hook's formula would look like that, F equals K times delta X, where delta X, if this is the spring, and there is a force over here, delta X would be the change in length for the spring. This is the actual Hooke's law. However, we have extended this law to our materials because it looks pretty much the same. It's not exactly the same, of course, but it looks like that. So here we have the stresses which are equal to the modulus of elasticity, or Young's modulus, as you will read here, times the strain. So when it comes to engineering applications, Hooke's law would be this one instead of the first one that I wrote here on the top. So please keep that in mind. Now, it has been observed that the same applies on shear stresses and shear strains. However, this factor is not exactly the same. It is not the modulus of elasticity. So it is a different modulus, and we refer to that as the shear modulus. However, there is a relationship between the modulus of elasticity and the shear modulus, and we'll actually show that later on, which means that the shear modulus is also characteristic of the material, and this is quite useful for us. Now, since we have defined the volumetric strain, you can see that, again, we can have another modulus, volume or bulk modulus, that can be used to define the relationship between stresses and strains when it comes to changing volume. Now, something else that was observed, again, experimentally, was that when you try to apply a force on an element, so in other words, you apply a stress on this element, it will deform, but not only in the direction in which the stress applies. For example, in this example over here, we have a tensile force, a force that tends to pull apart the two ends of this element. So it will increase in length. We will certainly have an increase in length. So we can define the strain horizontally. However, it was noticed that it will also decrease in length in the other dimensions. It makes sense because, well, it is not that easy to actually increase the space between particles of an element. So when you only apply a force in one direction, it will tend to keep its initial volume. And because of this tendency, there will be some lateral deformation. Lateral refers to the direction of the force and, of course, of the strain that we calculate. So anything that is in a perpendicular direction is a lateral strain. Now, if you measure this lateral strain, you will see that it is proportional to the longitudinal strain, or the actual strain that we were discussing about so far. And this ratio of the lateral strain over the longitudinal strain is also related to the material used. For example, for steel, this ratio has been found to be approximately 0.3. So if you have a specimen and it is elongated, let's say, by 1 centimeter, then its other dimensions should be shortened by 3 millimeters. So this is quite useful. This guy here, Poisson, is the one who studied this phenomenon. Yes, it is 0.3. It's 0.3 for steel, of course, not for any kind of element. There are materials that have a much larger or much smaller Poisson's ratio. And these are properties that are actually utilized for various applications. So there are applications where we want to limit this effect as much as possible, and applications where we might actually want something like that. In civil engineering, we typically try to limit strain. We don't want additional strains in our elements. But in mechanical applications, there are quite a few cases where we might even want that. So, yeah, it depends. Nevertheless, this is a very useful observation because now there is a relationship to correlate strains in any direction with the initial stresses that cause these strains. So here you can see that if we apply this relationship in the initial Hooke's law, of course, as I said, when we refer to Hooke's law, when we refer to the relationship relates stresses and strains in our materials, we can see that we can get the lateral strain as a function of the normal stress, or the initial stress, it could be a shear one. Now, when it comes to stresses and strains, as we saw earlier, we have a lot of different stresses. So we have the same number of strains in an element. Just to remind you what it looked like through both before and after the yielding point. Yes, So I see the question here, if the plus one effect is applies before and after the yielding point. Yes, it does apply before and after the yielding point. Typically, we will assume that this ratio would be the same. However, it is not necessarily the same. So this, let me go back here. This coefficient here might change after yielding. But in most of our applications, we assume that it is the same, that it remains the same. Very interesting question, though. So just to remind you what we saw earlier regarding stresses, we saw that depending on the surface of the element, the stresses would be defined differently. The same applies on the strains as well. So, for example, in this direction, we would have normal strains. So, if we use the same coordinate system, x, y, and z, this would be this would be epsilon z, and this would be epsilon x. And here, this would be gamma y x. This would be gamma y z. This one would be gamma z y. This one, gamma z x, gamma x z, and gamma x y. So once again, you can see that we have a lot of different strains, normal and shear strains defined on the element. Something that we are doing is to use matrices in order to define the relationship between stresses and strains. Now, I mentioned earlier that there is a relationship between the shear modulus and Young's modulus, or the modulus of elasticity, and it is the relationship that you see over here. Now, you can see that the shear modulus, G, and the modulus of elasticity, E, are related to each other using the Poisson ratio as well. So all of these three are related to each other. And as I said, all of these three are characteristic of the material that we are studying. Now, using matrices, it is easy to represent the relationship between stresses and strains. And when we use matrices, well, this would be the this one. Let me show it over here. Would be the, sorry, the stress matrix. This would be the strain matrix. And this one over here will be a matrix that shows how much the material resists in deforming. So in other words, how stiff the material might be. Now, as you can imagine, especially if we use the Hooke's law that we saw earlier, the larger the modulus of elasticity, the larger the required stress in order to have the same amount of strain. In other words, we would need to put much more effort into deforming this object by the same amount if the modulus of elasticity was larger. So, in other words, this material would be more stiff than another one that it would be easier to deform. So, because of that, this component over here, this matrix, is what we call the stiffness matrix. And this is characteristic of the material, as you can see in the simplified form below. We can use E over 1 minus V squared. Actually, this one is nu squared. Anyway, as a common factor, so it can be simplified. But nevertheless, this is a generalized relationship between stresses and strains. So instead of having a stress and a strain, what we have is a stress matrix, which is related to the strain matrix using this stiffness matrix. Now, for stiffness, we use letter K instead, to be honest. So this is the generalized Hooke's law. It is Hooke's law in a matrix form. Now, we mentioned earlier that for all kinds of materials, there is a limit up to which any deformation will be elastic. So if we remove the force from the element, then it should return to its initial state. But after this point, the strains and the stresses will not be proportional to each other. And because of that, also, there will be some remaining deformations on the element. This limit at which the stresses and strains are not anymore proportional to each other is also referred to as the limit of proportionality. For example, for steel, the limit of proportionality is also the yielding point. We just use a different term because we just try to define and to describe a different phenomenon for this material. Now, depending on our materials, the performance after this limit can vary. Nevertheless, if we go back, not back, but if we just study the performance of the materials, the elements, before we reach this limit of proportionality, so we are still in the elastic range of our curves, then if we draw a load over extension curve, the overall work of the load, the energy required, if you want, to deform this element, can be defined as the area below the curve. So this is the area between two points. So in order to increase the extension of this element from 1 to let's call it theta 2, then we need that much additional work. So it's the one you see over here. Typically, the area is calculated using integrals. Of course, if it is a simple curve like this one, you could potentially use geometry that would be acceptable. But in stranger forms, for example, the curve, the stress strain curve we saw earlier for steel, which would be similar if we would draw the same for load and extension, then in that case you would need to use an integral. Now, if we integrate here, because we have a linear relationship, and this one, let me draw this shape, is a trapezoid, so the area can be easily calculated. 1/2 times the change in length times the average load applied on that. But you can also define the same formula using integration. And this is what we call the formula for the potential energy. It is a very useful formula because, depending on the materials, we can see how much energy a material could potentially absorb or dissipate in some cases. We need that because in civil engineering applications, we know that most actions on our structure actually can be translated into energy. For example, an earthquake on our structure is actually an amount of energy that is released from the faults and goes into our structure. The same applies, for example, for wind loads or even for people using a structure. Everything is energy. Now, if the structure is able to receive this amount of energy safely, then we have designed the structure safely. If it cannot receive this amount of energy, then there will be damage. So there is a correlation between the energy inserted to the system that we're studying, in our case, the structure, and its performance. I don't want to go into too much theory, to be honest. I would be happy to do that, but we don't have time. Let's not dwell on that. But as you can see over here, it is possible to correlate pretty much all values to each other using the theory we have seen so far. So here we have the definitions of direct stress and direct strain, or the normal stress and normal strain. And of course, you can see how they are related to each other. And something that is interesting to see is that if you solve for the force, this factor over here, the area times the modulus of elasticity over the initial length, is something that depends on the member. The modulus of elasticity depends on the material, and the area and the initial length depend on the design of the element. Now, as you can see, for the elastic branch, the larger this ratio is, the more difficult it would be for this element to, or this member, as you read over here, to deform. So this is why we refer to that as the stiffness of the member. Of course, I want you to keep in mind that this is the case over here, where we have force P, and this is the initial length. So this is the case that we have axial deformation on this member. In other words, we will see later on that we would refer to that as the axial stiffness of the member. Because when it comes, for example, to bending moments, there's a different kind of stiffness that we need to calculate. Again, it is related to the member, but it is calculated differently. Now, let me not go into too much detail over here. You can go through these slides on your own and perhaps ask me any questions that you might have. As I said, I would be happy to do all of this analytically, but the time is quite limited. Actually, let's see an application of this theory anyway. Now, what we have here is a simple truss. A simple truss is a truss comprising only two members. These red highlighted members that you see over here. Now, in a simple truss, we can have loads only on one of the joints, which is the one between the members, because the other two are used to support the element. So if we had a load on these points, it would be directly received by the support. So the whole structure would not be stressed. Also, in trusses, we have mentioned that the loads should only apply on the joints. So we should not have a load on the members, only on the connections between the members, these hinges between the members. Now, here we have W. This load, it could be perhaps a weight that is hanging over there. So it is possible to calculate the internal forces of these two bars, this truss. Now, to do that, we can apply equilibrium of the forces horizontally and vertically. Let me just remind you how we would do that. We would assume that we cut somewhere over here. We would draw the internal forces of the two elements as if they were tensile. And of course, if we get a negative sign, it means that they are compressive. So this one would be PAB. And this one would be PAC. Now, if we analyze PAB into components, we would get PABY and PABX. We would still have PAC. And do not forget the load on this joint, W, which is also over here. So if we come to this sketch and we apply the equations of equilibrium, this is the sum of forces in y direction, which has to be equal to zero, and this is the sum of forces in x direction, which has to be equal to zero. And of course, this is x and this is y. So from this second sketch, the one over here, you can see that PABY has to be equal to W. So this element AB or BA will be in tension because BABY will be equal to something times W, so it will be positive. But then if we substitute PABX, which we can calculate using trigonometry, we will see that PAC will be in compression. It is logical. It makes sense. Also, it can be visualized quite easily if we try to imagine how this thrust would form. Let me just draw this here on the top. So if this is my thrust, and I have a load over here, W, this load would tend to push this point downwards, so it would tend to come over here, which means that this element would tend to increase in length. Whereas this element, I should do this dashed line, but that's okay, would not necessarily tend to increase in length, because after all, this would also move a bit inwards, it would tend to decrease in length. Now, here we have the internal forces of these elements. Let's see what it means for the elements themselves. Now, if we wanted to calculate the energy, the strain energy accumulated in the truss because of this deformation, it is possible to do so using the formula that we saw earlier. The forces in the elements are axial, so this U would be the potential energy in the elements, or the strain energy as we refer to that. So we can see that for UAB, this would be 1.4 times W squared. Let me have a look. This is a bit strange. Why does it look like that? 0. To be honest, I would expect this one to be squared as well. I'm not sure why it looks like that over here. I know why L0 is 1.41L, but then this one should be cubed. This comes from a textbook anyway, so I assume it should be correct. But to be honest, I would expect this one, well, this 1.41 to be squared, and then again multiplied by that, so cubed, divided by 2. So I assume that it has already been simplified with this 2. Let me just do the calculation to verify that. Yeah, this is the case. So, it looks like that because it has been simplified. So it would make sense. So you can see here how we could work out the overall work done by the force. Is there there any question up to this point? I understand that when a presentation is too theoretical, it might look like a lot of information. But of course, you will have the opportunity to go through these slides and perhaps the presentation on your own again. If there's any question, I would be happy to discuss it with you. Otherwise, we could have a break. So is there any question at this point? Okay, I don't see anyone else typing, so I assume that the same applies for all of you. So let us have a short break now, and we could be back around 4 past 11. So let me pause the recording, and I will resume it when we will be back. So, in this example, what we saw was how to calculate the total strain energy in a simple truss. But of course, to do that, what we needed is to assume, actually, before I go over here, to assume that the two elements comprising the truss A, B, and A, C would deform similarly, not similarly, exactly, that their displacements would be compatible. So in other words, the deformation of this element would be such that the end of this element A would meet the end of this element AB. In other words, what we assumed is that the displacements in the system should be compatible. Of course, the same principle applies on single elements as well. So in general, when we have elements that consist of different components. For example, here you can see a reinforced concrete element, perhaps a column. So a reinforced concrete element consists of the concrete rubber, but also the reinforcing bars. It is quite clear that in this element, when deformations occur, for example, as what you see over here, if you have a force on this column, a compressive force that tends to compress the whole column, it makes sense that the deformations of the concrete should be the same as the deformation of steel. If they were not the same, this would imply that the two components of the same element, the steel bars and the concrete, would perform as if they were independent to each other. However, of course, this is not the case. In our elements, we assume that we have what we call a composite action, meaning that they perform as one. So their deformations should be the same, especially when it comes to reinforced concrete. The deformations under any scenarios are the same, and this is actually something quite useful. Do you know, except for the fact that steel has a better performance under tensile loads, what other reasons are behind the selection of steel as a reinforcing material for concrete? Yes, this is the this was certainly the primary reason behind that. But of course, there is something else that was considered for steel, because someone might say, well, okay, we have been using steel, why not use, for example, titanium or another metal? Let me give you an example. Steel doesn't perform that well when it comes to corrosive substances. So, for example, if we are in an extreme environment, perhaps near the sea or in the sea, then we need to take this into consideration and try to protect our reinforcement with various methods that we have available in order to ensure that the steel rebars will not corrode. Now, why not use, let's say, aluminium that does not rust? And use steel as a reinforcement material for concrete. The strength could be a factor, certainly, but it is not the only one, because, for example, we could use something stronger than steel with even much larger strength. So that would be quite convenient to design smaller elements. Any other ideas? Cost. Yes, cost could be a factor, certainly, yeah. Actually, all of these factors have been considered when it came to design of elements. Fire resistance, depends. It is good compared to other elements. For example, some kind of polymers. Nowadays, you can see a lot of research being done in using polymers instead of steel. However, they are not perfect. I have worked with polymers myself, and I know about that. It is something that is quite simple. And keep in mind that because we have been using reinforced concrete for more than a century now, it is something that should have been observed, well, let's say 200 or 300 years ago. A titanium is too heavy. Titanium is not that heavy. Titanium is actually quite light. It's a very, very useful metal. So, not only just light, but can also deform elastically a lot. So it might receive very large deformations and still remain elastic. Degrade the concrete? No. Okay. I really enjoyed hearing about your thoughts. And as I said, all of these factors have been considered with regards to selecting a reinforcing material. So, yeah, all of these were considered: the strength, the cost, the fire resistance, everything. However, there is a main factor that has to do with the everyday use of the structures. It has to do with thermal expansion. Something that was noticed is that steel has approximately the same rate of thermal expansion as concrete, which makes it quite useful because we will construct our structure in a particular temperature. So if the temperature increases or decreases, then they expand or contract by the same rate. It means that there will not be additional stresses in the element. As I mentioned earlier, there are other types of reinforcement proposed nowadays and sometimes used as well. But these other materials do not have exactly the same thermal expansion factor. This was actually a coincidence. This is not by design. They just noticed that these elements, these materials, I'm sorry, are compatible with each other. And this is one of the main reasons why it has been used so widely instead of other materials. We will see an application later on that takes this into consideration as well. Nevertheless, let's go back to our example over here. So what we have here is an element that, well, it is a reinforced concrete element, is a composite element. It comprises components of at least two different materials. So what should apply in this element is that the deformations of the concrete and the deformations of the steel reinforcement should be exactly the same. So here, what will happen is that, well, it will shrink a little bit. We will have some contraction over here. So the change in length for the steel bars should be equal to the change in length for the concrete, let's say, for the concrete column. So, applying this compatibility of displacement condition, the change in length for the concrete should be equal to the change in length for the steel component. If we substitute over here, assuming that part of the force is received by the concrete and part of the force is received by the steel, we get this this formula that you see over here, or in a well, not that much simplified form, you can see on the right hand side. Nevertheless, we can get a relationship between the overall force on the column and the force on steel. We can do the same for concrete. And something that I want you to notice is that if we add together this one and, well, this one, what will happen with this fraction, because the denominator is the same, in the numerator we will have AC times EC plus AS times CS, which is equal to the denominator, which means that this fraction will be 1. So PS plus PC equals P. So it can be confirmed that these are formulas which are compatible with each other. Now, since they are compatible to each other, the vertical displacement of the element can be calculated like that. In other words, if we want to correlate the force with the vertical displacement, now, if you remember earlier, we said that A times E over L0 is what we refer to as stiffness. I mentioned that this is the axial stiffness of the element because it has to do with axial forces. So here, what you see is a similar formula that would say that AC times EC plus AES times ES, I'm sorry for my handwriting, I know it's not perfect, over L times delta to give us this the axial stiffness of the element. So for this composite element, this would be the axial stiffness. In other words, when it comes to the composite element, this product over here is the sum of AI times EI, where I is the material. So this is the area of the concrete times the modulus of the concrete, the elastic or the Young's modulus of the concrete, plus the area of the steel times the modulus of steel. Let me do it over here. Yes. So, in general, what I want you to keep in mind, instead of all of these formulas, is this fact over here, that when we want to calculate the axial stiffness of a composite element, we just need to add together the products of the area times the Young's modulus for the element. If you remember that, together with the formula for an element of a single material, which is the formula down here, that would be adequate. You don't need to prove anything. This is just to show how this works out. So all you need to keep from this slide and perhaps from the ones from now on is just this part. Is it clear why for a composite element, actually it could be proven for any number of different components in the same element, the product of the area times the Young's modulus would be the sum of the individual products? Matthew, do you refer to this box over here? It's sigma for the sum of AI times EI. If you want me, I can repeat it. Okay, perfect. I refer to the material, yes, yes. So, yeah, it could be C or S or anything else in another case. Yeah. Is there perhaps another question here? As I said, I understand that this presentation is quite theoretical, most of it at least, so it might seem like quite a lot. I'm happy to see that you can grasp it relatively easily. Okay, so as I said, this compatibility of displacement is something that we are using a lot when it comes to composite materials, composite elements instead of full structures. Of course, it applies on structures, as we saw in the truss earlier, but it applies on elements as well. Now, I refer to the expansion of the two materials earlier because, as I said, this is something that we will use in reinforced concrete elements too. Now, what we have here could be a beam. Now, if in this beam, due to temperature rise or drop, it tends to expand or contract, but for some reason we want to prevent that. A very good reason is that this element should not change in length. For example, if this was, let's say, a simply supported beam or something like that, which actually is a bridge, we would not want the bridge to shrink or expand. Perhaps expansion would not be that big of a deal, but certainly we would not want it to shrink. So we would, instead of simple support, we might try to prevent that using, let's say, it could be pin support or perhaps even fixed. Now, if we try to prevent that, but it tends to change in length, then stresses will develop in the element. To calculate these stresses, what we need to do, well, not much, because it has been solved for us already, is a formula, this formula over here, that correlates the strains due to thermal expansion and stresses. Now, the strains due to thermal expansion are the change in temperature times a coefficient. Now, this coefficient depends on the material. So, different materials have a different coefficient of thermal expansion. So, as you can see here, if the strain was initially related to the stresses through Hooke's law, so sigma equals E times epsilon, and epsilon equals alpha times delta T. So sigma due to thermal expansion would be E times alpha times delta T. So Young's modulus times the coefficient of thermal expansion times the change in the temperature. So here, from this slide, what I want you to keep is just this formula over here. Or perhaps even just correlation between the formula we could use to calculate the strain due to thermal expansion. So, when it comes to reinforced concrete elements, well, the strain of each component for both materials should be the same. Now, we could see what would happen here if we could have free expansion. And what happens if the expansion is somehow restricted? Now, in this example, this does not necessarily have to be steel, but nevertheless, it could be any component in which the temperature changes. Now, if we have a material, not necessarily steel, as I said, or it could be a steel of a different grade that does not have exactly the same rate of expansion as the concrete, the additional stresses transferring from one component to the other due to the change in the rate of expansion can be calculated like that. So, if you see over here, in the restricted expansion, the displacements for these elements can be calculated with this formula. And these formulas are exactly the ones that we used earlier. these have to do with the stresses applied on the element. The stresses are a product of the thermal expansion. So if we substitute the stress, which is P over A, with earlier, let me just show the formula again, this one over here, E times A times delta T. What we would get is that, well, the sum of this would be delta T times the difference in the coefficients. In other words, what we see over here is that, well, this is stress over the modulus of elasticity, or this is the strain due to the change in temperature. So the overall strain in the material would be delta T over S minus AC. Of course, if these two are equal to each other, you can see that this is practically zero, or zero if they are exactly equal to each other. And this is why it is quite useful, because, well, if this is zero, we, as I mentioned earlier, we have no additional stresses due to thermal expansion. Now, I'm over here. Sorry. Yeah, so in this example, it is assumed that one of the components would tend to deform differently than the other one. That's why you will see all of this working. As I mentioned, the case where they deform the same, it is a bit more different. Well, it is a bit easier because there is no additional stress in the element. However, if the rate of expansion was different, then this is how it would be calculated in this case. I should probably not go into more detail here. It is better if we see an example to see what how it can be applied. Now, in this example, what we have is a rigid slab which is supported by three columns. Now, the slab has a total weight of 100 kilonewtons. The columns are 4 meters high, and the cross-sectional area of all of these columns is 300 square millimeters. Now, the outer columns consist of a material that has a Young's modulus about 80,000 megapascals, and of newtons over square millimeter is a megapascal. For example, this could be aluminium. And the inner column has a material with Young's modulus of 200 gigapascals, for example, steel. Now, in this case, because the slab is rigid, which means that it restricts the deformations of the elements, so all of them should deform similarly, it is mentioned here that, well, what happens is that the temperature inside this structure is increased by 100 degrees Celsius. Now you can see that the materials, not only do they have different modules of elasticity, but they also have different coefficient of thermal expansion, which means that they would tend to deform differently, not only under the compressive load of the slab, but also under the change in temperature. However, the deformations of the materials should be compatible. So let's see what this means for these elements. Now, as we saw in the previous example for the composite column, what we did was to add together the sums, the products of the area times the modulus of elasticity for each material. We can apply exactly the same principle over here, because after all, if I go back, you could imagine this whole structure as if it was the composite column of the previous example. So this whole system performs as one. So you could apply exactly the same principle when it comes to loading of the elements. So the area of the outer columns times the modulus of elasticity of the outer columns plus the area of the inner column times the modulus of elasticity of that would be, in this case, the denominator. Now, the area for all columns is 300 square millimeters, but we have two columns, two outer columns and one internal column. So you can see here, this is the number of columns, this is the area, this is the modulus of elasticity. Here there's no number because it is one. This is the area and this is the modulus of elasticity. Outer, inner, inner. So this would be the result. First of all, I would like to ask you if this is correct in your opinion. Very good. This is partially correct. Okay, if you would do something like that in a test, you would get some marks, but certainly not all of them, because it is missing the units. So don't forget the units. Now, let's see the units. Here, this one is in millimeters squared. This one is in megapascals or newtons per millimeters squared. So what would the units be over here? Well, you can see that the millimeters squared cancel each other out. So the result would be in newtons. Of course, the fact that this is in newtons does not imply that this product is a force. So the units do not necessarily relate to the physical meaning of a component, in this case, the denominator of this fraction. But nevertheless, do not forget the units. It is very, very important. As I said, I will keep repeating that throughout the whole module. So at some point, you might hate me for that, but you will thank me for that when it comes to the exams. Anyway, so let's go back to the stresses. So the stresses due to the load of the slab, for the inner column, it will be, well, here you can see what it looks like. Let me go back. Anyway, let me write the formula over here. So sigma I would be EI times times the actual the total load EI times say I over the sum of EI okay, it can be confusing here because we're using I for internal and also for everything else. So instead of I, let me use J. I hope it will make it a bit more clear instead of confusing. Times the total stress or times P over A. And sigma O would be EO times AO, or the other way around, it's exactly the same, over the sum of EJ times AJ. And of course, the sum of EJ times AJ is this one over here. So this is an average stress for the elements. Nevertheless, you can see how much the stress in the internal and in the external, in the external columns would be due to the load on top of them. So this is just because of the load here. The load is 100 kilonewtons, so let me have a look. We'll call it sigma then. It is this is the load and okay. Yeah, I see what happens over here. It is not just like let me show you how this formula looks like. The top one, this one or the So this one, this formula is practically the one over here that says that sigma, let's say J, equals for each component EJ times AJ over the sum of E okay, let me call it sigma k. I know it can be a bit confusing if we keep adding variables, but EJ times AJ times the load over the area of that. Now, in general, this formula is a simplification of this one because here AK and AK cancel each other out. So this is the formula that we used earlier in the composite column to distribute the stresses. It is an application of the formula down here, but instead of just sigma, use the force over the area of this element. I hope it makes it more clear and certainly not more confusing. But because these two-way k's cancel each other out, we get this formula instead. No, there is no reason for that. It is just the way it was in the textbook. We could be using any letter, to be honest. We try to use F or P. P typically refers to point loads. But it is the same. It's exactly the same. Okay, so what we did over here was just to apply the formula to distribute the stresses on each element. Now, we will try to calculate the stresses on the elements due to the thermal expansion and then the total stresses on each column. Now, due to the thermal effects, what happens is that, well, actually, let me go back to the first slide. We see that the outer columns have a larger coefficient of thermal expansion than the inner columns. It means that for the same change in temperature, the outer columns would tend to expand more than the inner column. What this means is that while the outer columns tend to expand, the inner column would tend to resist to this change in length because it wants to expand, but not that much. So this means that the inner column would practically be in tension because the outer columns would tend to pull its top upwards, while the outer columns, because of the reaction of the inner column, would be in compression. It is action and reaction here again. So this is actually what is shown in these formulas. So let me just sketch it over here. The outer columns would tend to expand like that. The inner column would tend to expand like that. This is if the expansion was free. Yes, the recording will be on canvas. And also, just to make sure that all of you have access to that, I copy the recording from the conferences section to the modules section as well. So it will be available in both sections for you to watch again if you need to. Yes. So we have the rigid slab. Due to the external columns, this internal one would be lifted upwards, and due to the internal column, the external ones would be pushed downwards. So, because of that, we can apply the formula we saw earlier to calculate the stresses due to the thermal expansion. So here, sigma equals delta T times the change, the difference in the coefficients of thermal expansion times, well, the rest. This is E0 times, EO times AI times EI over the sum of these. In other words, this part over here in reality, this part over here would be actually E over A. It would be epsilon O, the strain of the outer column. And this coefficient, actually this product over here, would be epsilon I, the strain for the internal column due to expansion. So here we have just substituted all the values in the formula to calculate the stresses in the elements. Now, when it comes to compatibility of the formations, of course, the rule of superposition also applies here. So if we apply this rule to the elements, we just need to add together the stresses due to these two actions, the loads and the thermal loads. So the internal column would be in compression, but the outer columns would be in compression as well, but a different amount of compression. This is because they perform differently. So this is because they have a different elasticity modulus as well as a different factor of thermal expansion. This is all with this example, to be honest. So what we did over here was to just apply the formulas we saw earlier for the stresses due to loads and the stresses due to thermal loads or thermal expansion, and the formula for compatibility. What did you get? 185 and 74.1. They are from the previous working. So let me actually say, discuss what these are over here. So these are due to load, and these are due to temperature. I just see someone typing. Is there any question on this example? All we need to do is to just apply the formulas for the stresses due to the two cases and add together the stresses, and that was all for the result.
Well, in general, when it comes to signs, they do matter because they are related to whether something is in compression or in tension. It just happens here that, in the textbook where this example comes from, they did not consider the fact that this one is in compression. So there should be a negative sign over here, or perhaps here, just to be to make it compatible. What I would have done in this example was to use a negative sign for the tensile stresses, so the result would be positive, because typically positive stresses show tension. But overall, what matters is what we call the engineering intuition, meaning that if we know that something is in compression and something else is in tension, we should be able to work out the result regardless of the signs. So, yeah, typically if we do this well, more strictly, I would certainly have used a negative sign over here to get a positive result, and then add together instead of the way that it has been worked out. Also, actually, this is a good opportunity to mention something. Something that I want all of you to keep in mind, and then we will go to our last break for today, is that in general, what I want to see and what I expect to see from you when it comes to assessment is that you understand how structures would perform, and you understand what you're doing. For example, in the past I was teaching other modules as well, or perhaps in a module like this one, and students would work out question and perhaps get results that seem to be quite strange. For example, a student got a bending moment on a hinge. Now, we should know that a hinge should have a zero moment. Of course, this would be a mistake, and well, when I was a student, this was enough for someone to fail the whole module. Of course, it's not the case here. Nevertheless, this student mentioned that, no, I know that this is incorrect. I know that I should get a zero moment here, so I recognize that I have made a mistake, but I don't have time to go back and correct my calculations. Well, when it came to marking, I gave this student almost all of the marks, because after all, well, for the student, this was not a mathematical problem, but a mechanical problem. He understood what he should get, he understood what was wrong with that, and in the end, this is the whole point. After all, in practice, most of these calculations will be done by software, but keep in mind that in the software, the principle rubbish in, rubbish out applies all the time. It means that depending on how the numbers are given to the software, the results might be totally incorrect. Even if you do everything perfectly, almost all structural software have various bugs, if not mistakes. It is up to you to understand if what you get from the software is correct or not. So what I expect to see from you is exactly that, that you can understand how things work. If you can show that, then that is the best outcome of this module, actually the most important learning outcome of this module. Anyway, so let's go into a break of about 10 minutes. So if we would all be back at 10 past, then we will start the last part of this long lecture. Thank you very much, and see you in 10 minutes. I will pause the recording now. And now, what we will see is a specific case of stresses and strains, but in this case, stresses on a structure. Now, this is a case which is of particular because even though we do recognize that we have stresses and strains, of course, in three dimensions, we saw earlier that actually we have a large number of different types of stresses and strains. Still, there are conditions under which it is much easier to describe the stresses or the strains, or perhaps both of them, in these conditions. And because it is easier, it makes our life much easier because it is much simpler to work everything out. Now, one of such cases is the case of plane stress. And let me explain what plane stress means. The plane stress condition is the condition in which the stresses on an or inside perhaps an element are practically acting on a single plane. In other words, there is one direction in which the stresses will be zero. So this means that from a three-dimensional model, we could go to a two-dimensional one, and using our theory, most of the two-dimensional problems can be easily solved. Now, such a case is the case of a cylindrical closed tube. It could be a pressure vessel, for example. So, in this pressure vessel, we have a gas inside, or a liquid, but typically a gas. Under specific pressure, typically much larger than the atmospheric pressure. So, because of that, the gas inside the pressure vessel pushes the walls of the vessel outwards. So, the gas inside the vessel would act as you see over here. So, it would tend to push all of the walls outwards. Now, if we could get a section of that and see what this would look like. So, on the circumference of the vessel, we would have pressure acting outwards like that. And we refer to that as the circumferential pressure. But we would also have pressure acting on the top and the bottom of this vessel. In this case, it would be normal. So this is the circumferential one. And this one, I don't really need to sketch it because you can see it over here. So this be the circumferential pressure, and this would be well, this one would actually be plane. Well, because this pressure tends to be parallel to the axis of this element, this is called the longitudinal pressure. Now, it can be proven that the circumferential pressure is the same all over the vessel. And it makes sense because if, for example, the pressure acting, let's say, in this sketch to the right was larger than the one acting to the left, then it would tend to deform a bit differently. However, what happens to this vessel, is that it expands in the same rate. So this would be the case. The pressure would be exactly the same. This is quite useful because we can simplify our problem. And what is our problem? Our problem is to design this, in this case, this vessel. But to design it, we need to define the stresses on the element at various points, and based on these stresses, select the thickness of the element or the type of material to use for that. Now, if we come over here, on one side of the element, over its circumference, what we will see is that due to this expansion, due to the fact that it tends to expand internally, the vessel itself would tend to resist this kind of deformation. Because it tends to resist, it tends to try to avoid the internal expansion. Now, the stresses due to the gas inside along its circumference would be SC, the circumferential pressure that we referred to earlier. Now, this SC is the same all over the element. However, because we have the pressure acting at the two ends of the element, this pressure tends to elongate the whole element. So what happens on the side walls of the element is that we also have this longitudinal pressure on the element too. So if we can calculate the circumferential and the longitudinal pressure, what happens on this element is that the stress conditions are like that. So practically, we can simulate this three-dimensional element as a two-dimensional problem, which we can solve much easier. This is because we don't really have any pressure, any stress in the element acting outwards. It makes sense that we don't have any stress because we would need to have also a reaction to that. So if we had a stress and no reaction, it would imply that the element would tend to deform indefinitely. Hence, because we have stresses in two directions only, and not in the third one, this is a problem of plane stress. So stresses are acting on a particular plane. Of course, for a very small area of this vessel, because in reality it is curved. But if this is very small, it can be safely simulated with a plane rectangle of very small dimensions that you see over here. Now, it can be proven, but we will not prove it, that the longitudinal pressure can be calculated using this formula over here. It is P times D over 4 times T. Now, P is the pressure of the content, the gas perhaps in it, D is the diameter of the vessel, and T is the thickness of the cross section. So if this would be a cross section of our vessel, this would be D, and any of these would be T. Also, to calculate the circumferential pressure, we can use this formula. As I said, you will not have to prove any of these. You can take them as they are. It is not difficult to prove them, but there is certainly not enough time to show all of this. Where, once again, you can see that it relates to the pressure inside the vessel, the diameter of the cross-section, and the thickness. Also, what we can see is that, if I go back to the previous slide, the longitudinal pressure is actually half of the circumferential pressure. So, I can write this over here. Sigma L is actually sigma C over 2. This is something that you could use, not necessarily, but it might help you to remember one formula instead of the other, if needed. Now, since we know the longitudinal and circumferential pressure on this element, we can apply our theory to calculate the strains on the element, or the stresses on it. Now, the longitudinal strain would be, well, the longitudinal stress over E, which is what would happen if there was no lateral deformation in the element, but due to Poisson's law, we know that there will be some lateral deformation as well. Now, let's see why this one applies over here. Well, here, what we've got is the effect of the circumferential pressure or the circumferential stress on the elongation of this element. And this is why it has to be multiplied by Poisson's ratio, because sigma C tends to change its size laterally, while here we're considering the effect of this stress in the change in size in the other direction. I see someone typing, so I assume there might be a question. I can tell you almost certainly that in this semester you will not be sitting a written exam. It will have to be an alternative exam. Unless we get different instructions, for this semester I cannot be a written exam due to the COVID restrictions. Now, if that was a written exam, or if we get different instructions later on, I do not expect that to happen myself. then yes, you will certainly be given a formula sheet with the main equations. So yeah, you're not expected to remember everything by heart. This is the way that you can calculate the longitudinal strain due to the longitudinal stress and circumferential stress. Let's see why this one is negative. Now, just try and draw this over here, or perhaps I could add another slide. Let me do that instead. So it is quite clear why sigma L tends to elongate that, but let's see what happens due to sigma C. Now, sigma C, if I could draw just a part of that. So sigma C tends to change its dimensions over here, sigma C and sigma C. So if this is the deformed shape, let me draw with a dashed line the initial shape. So the initial shape would be something like that. Because the change in when the change in length is positive in the direction of the stress, the change in length in the other directions is negative, it reduces in length. This is why you have a negative sigma C over E, but then we said that it is proportional to the initial change in length, and it is related to that due to Poisson's ratio. So this is negative nu times sigma C over E. So this would be the longitudinal strain due to sigma C. Yes, for steel it would be 0.3. Now, similarly, when we have the longitudinal stress, it tends to change its circumferential dilation, because if this is sigma L, and let's say that this was the initial shape. So sigma L also tends to shrink it in the other direction. So we will see that a similar formula is used to calculate the effect of the longitudinal stress in the circumferential dilation of the structure, the circumferential strain. So this is the case over here. Because we said that sigma L is half sigma C, this is why we have this 1 over 2 and here as well. Now, we can also apply the same formulas to calculate the increase in volume and, of course, the volumetric strain in this case. As I said, I don't want to go into too much detail to go and prove something that is already there. There's no need for that. Sometimes it might be useful, but if we keep referring to that, then we will not have time for more. Nevertheless, you can see that, again, this is related to the same values, the pressure, the diameter, and the thickness of the vessel. Here comes the Poisson's ratio and, of course, the modulus of elasticity for the element. In order to get these formulas, what we had to assume, of course, is the compatibility of deformations. So once again, we assume that the deformations due to the longitudinal stresses and the deformations due to the circumferential stresses should be compatible with each other. And this is how we ended up adding this together and getting these formulas. This is one case that is of interest for us, plane stress, where the stress can be assumed to be acting on a single plane, because we used the principles that we would use in this simple shape to calculate formulas or to define formulas for a more complex problem like this one. This is why plane stress can be of interest. This is not the only case where we have plane stress. There are other elements in our structures, for example, shear walls, that are also in plane stress. And there are formulas that can be used for them too. Actually, the design formulas are based on the mechanical formulas that we had developed in the past. Now, apart from plane stress, we can also have plane strain. Now, let's see what the difference between these two is. If I go back to this example, for plane stress, what I will notice is that the strain here will not be in two dimensions, but practically in three dimensions, while the stress would be simplified like that. Whereas in this case, the stresses might be different. However, the strains should be the same. An example where the strains should be the same in not the same, sorry, should be acting, should be developed, sorry, on a plane. So we should have strains only in two directions. Is the case of retaining walls, or perhaps slabs. So even typical slabs in our structures would be under plane strain. The case with the slabs or the retaining walls is that we have an element where we have stresses acting like that. And here the deformations can be modeled in a way that we can come up with formulas based on the simplified approach that strains are on a plane. We will not go into more detail here because, as I said, this module covers a variety of topics. So if we would go into too much detail on each one of them, it would be quite difficult to cover. So that would be actually all for today's presentation. As I said, I do understand that it was quite theoretical. It had a lot of additional theory. But if you have any questions that you would like to discuss now, I would be happy to do so. And if not, of course, please have a look at the notes and perhaps the recording again, and feel free to get in contact with me. Now, is there any question, something that you would like to discuss at this point? Yes, so I see a couple of questions. Well, regarding the assessment for this module, well, it will comprise two components. The first one is actually a coursework. Now, but to be honest, both of them are courseworks. But the first one is, let's say, a portfolio submission. It is partially a coursework, and which substitutes the in-class tests that we would typically have, and partially a laboratory report. Now, due to the COVID restrictions, and because it is not easy to use the labs, due to the restrictions, as I said, I will be recording the lab and share with you the recording as well as the results, so that you can prepare the report for this module. So this would be one component, and the other one would typically be an in-class written examination, but now again it will be a coursework submission. Now the both components would need to be submitted typically by the end of the semester, or typically it would be by the first week of January, but since we will be closing earlier, if I remember correctly, it's by the 20th or 21st of December. I'm not totally sure. I have to check on Canvas how it has been defined. it will be coursework submission actually for both components. Yeah. There's another question on whether there will be additional questions for this week. Well, yes, I will add some questions for you based on what we saw today, and they have to do mainly with the calculation of stresses and strains in elements. The coursework. Well, the coursework will be made available. Let me have a look over here. Okay, see, well, it is not explicitly mentioned, but let me explain how it works. So, for the final coursework, you will most probably have 1 week. Which means that it will be issued 1 week prior to the deadline. For the other coursework that is part of the portfolio submission, it would be similar, meaning that you will be given the coursework and then you'll have a week to work on that. Based on the schedule for delivery, you will be given one, let me have a look. So this is fourth week. And, you will be given one in 3 weeks' time. So the week commencing on the 9th of November. And another one, they are practically as mini tests as I could mention. And another one, 2 weeks after, no, 3 weeks after that, so by the 30th of November. And the last coursework will be on the, it will be issued the week commencing on the 14th of December. I believe it is better if I just add this information on Canvas instead, so that you can visit it rather than having to write this down. But yeah, it will be weeks 8, 11, and 13, based on the LTA schedule for that. Also, on week 9, the week commencing on the 16th of November, you will see on Canvas the video recording for the lab. So before that, actually, you will be given some instructions on the lab report, but this one can be submitted together with the last coursework anyway. So for this one, you will have certainly much more time to work on that. As I said, I will just write all of this in a different section on Canvas, so you can see all of that together. I hope this answers your question. Okay. Is there any other question overall? As I said, please have a look at the lecture notes as well as the recording if you want to, and feel free to get in contact with me. I'm always happy to reply quite fast and yeah. Okay, so let me end this presentation now.